Good morning, everybody. Welcome again on our second day. And somebody complained yesterday that why didn't we start with a prayer? I was expecting someone to answer him on my behalf. I don't know what happened, but normally when you have good intentions for the day, like the good intentions you had yesterday and today, that's already a prayer. Okay? But sometimes we intend to be extroverts, but God likes introverts. So can we have a moment of silence in Islamic, Arabic, Latin, and everybody makes his or her own prayer.
I like it.
Dear God, Hay is from Canada, all the way from Canada, Niagara, and she's looks quite a very well-built superintendent or somebody with wide experience on school issues, as we shall hear from her. And the session is going to be chaired by one of our big bosses of our function today, who plans and executes the teacher development, and that's none other than Damian Haganzwa, the director, Deputy Director General of TDM, Rwanda Education Board. And our next speaker is also a national experience, somebody who has lots to share with us across his experience at national level. And I'm sure it'll take us deeper into our Rwandan culture in terms of relationship between what we are doing, what we plan, and what is embedded in us. Are we importing anything foreign, or are we actually just touching base on our culture? So we shall learn a lot from him. And that session will be chaired by the Director General of WDA, but I don't see him yet in the room. But we shall improvise in case not around. Automatically, it will be Damian to continue chairing that session. Then we shall have a health break. You can stretch your limbs or have a drink, it's your choice. And then immediately after that, everybody will be ready to share with us a lot she has from whatever we have been exposed and from his or her experience. So please don't leave this room without making us aware of your presence. Let's share our experiences together so that we get enriched. And immediately after that panel discussion, then we shall have sharing of best practices from peer-to-peer learning. And we have some sector education officer who will do that. And we shall learn a lot from the ground. And then we shall have some field experience on TVET issues. And immediately after that, we shall have debriefing in terms of recommendations. And we shall have closing remarks from our Director General Rwanda Education Board. And then we part on a very good note after lunch. So it's a short day. And in any case, it's Friday, so it's understandable. But we want you to leave this place quite pregnant of ideas to take to the field. Thank you. Without wasting much time, I would now like to have a wrap-up of yesterday's ideas, what we shared, from Mr. Harriet, the program manager of VRB Rwanda. You have a choice to use this or
fantastic. Not easy to wrap up a day like yesterday. There were many eye-openers. We have learned a lot. We saw how the Rwandan government is really doing its utmost to increase the quality of education. We saw that Rwanda has brilliant, motivated school leaders. But we also realize that in other schools, not everything is hunky-dory, and that some serious problems are demanding urgent solutions. Dr. Robin Breese opened the floor by giving us a very interesting lecture on the theory and practice with regard to effective school leadership, effective in the 21st century. The roadmap of his presentation took us through five themes: the future for schools and school leadership, the importance of leadership in schools, current approaches to leadership, effective school leadership for the future, and developing effective school leaders. We were taught about cupcake-cut leaders and transactional, transformational, and transformative leadership. Robin made clear that it is up to Rwanda to choose its own methodology for school leadership, but that in the end, it is all about the future of the children, and that in a rapidly changing environment, 21st century leaders ought to be responsive change managers. They have to be creative, innovative, flexible, critical and resilient. And above all, they have to be value-driven people with thick skins and warm hearts. Mr. Mufunyi introduced us to the factors determining intrinsic and extrinsic teacher motivation, and to the complexity of the teacher-pupil relation and the many chickens and eggs that play a role in the education process, as well as the relentless efforts to put appropriate and new policies in place. You were also pointed out by Mr. Mufunyi that every reform requires particular school leadership and management needs that must be considered by policymakers. In the discussion, we learned about the need for collaborative competition between schools, and that schools are perceived by children as models for the society they are living in. If autocratic leadership is a model, then the society in which the children will be adults is likely to be autocratic too. We also were made understood that leadership is not necessarily age-bound. Leaders can be pretty young. And before lunch, Ruth gave us an insight in the valuable and many contributions of VSO in the field. In the afternoon, Susan Douglas, cunningly disguised as a bearded Dutchman named Hans Zout, gave us an interesting presentation on school leadership standards, the purpose of which is to clarify the minimum core expectations of school leaders for all stakeholders, including policymakers and officials, parents and the wider community, employers and students. We got an in-depth insight into the principles behind the standards and in the 80 dimensions of successful leadership. We also got to know that there is meanwhile convincing empirical evidence that the way school leaders perform on these 80 dimensions make the difference between mediocre, average, good or excellent schools. Then it was time for Eugène Rukieba, who explained the dire need for Rwanda to rush for its own talents, to rush for its own skills. Eugène emphasized furthermore on the need for highly talented and skilled school leaders, committed to and capable of improving teaching and learning achievements for every child. During the following discussions, we learned that any education system is only as good as the poorest experience of a child. We were explained that the College of Education has a postgraduate and a master in educational leadership, and that is also accessible for school-based studying. Then there was Cathy, rightly pointing out that gender sensitivity should be an intrinsic part of good leadership. It became also clear that leadership comes in a package, and that prioritization of leadership competences is really not possible. Although there are reasons enough to be positive about the evolution in the Rwandan education sector, Ruth made clear that there are also reasons to worry seriously. Every day that a child is in a school with a bad or a phony school leader is one day too many, and there should be urgent solutions for cases like that. Before closing time, however, Wellspring showed us again examples of wonderful head teachers out there in the field facing and dealing with challenges we can hardly imagine. It was a good day. It was a good day yesterday for educationalists, with lots of meaningful reflections and exchanges of innovative ideas. And we all grasped the paramount importance of good school leaders and the need for more synergy and efficient collaboration in the field of leadership training. Let us continue this important momentum now so that we can close this symposium with some solid resolutions for the further improvement of quality education in Rwanda. I thank you. Murakoze.
Thank you so much for those who prepared that resume. Without wasting our time, let's move straight to our keynote speaker, who is going to be introduced by the chairperson, Damian Nagaza. Over to you, sir.
Sue Greer comes from Canada, and she's a consultant in education leadership, and is dedicated to helping educational leaders build support and character of authentic professional learning at the district and school levels, which leads to improvement in educational effectiveness. Susan has been a teacher in the classroom. She has been a superintendent, not of police as we used to do in Rwanda, but of superintendent of schools. And she has served the district education board of Niagara Falls for over 22 years. In Aurora's superintendent, Sue's collaboration with Dr. Steve Katz has enabled her to focus her efforts on changing the learning in a system from culture of compliance to a culture of reflection and change practice. Systems leader of curriculum, she was able to support learning at the district level and to ensure that it's filtered through all professional learning up to key standard, key something 12. Sue has used an inquiry framework and has been experienced at all levels, as I've just mentioned, at the superintendent level, principal and teacher. Her work centers around collaborative inquiry, the challenges, the thinking and practice in the participant's role context. Sue can describe the learning journey of the Ontario publicly funded education system from lead knowers to lead learners, allowing authentic learning to take place in the relevant context where theory and practice come connected. Sue is the past director of Southwest Region of Ontario Public Supervisory Officers Association and has also served as the chair of the same organization. Sue's professional development committee, she currently serves as a mentor to newly hired superintendents across the province of Ontario. She has also worked in several school boards in Ontario in the capacity of a critical friend, meaning that she supports new principals and head teachers and what have you, and identifies her own areas of inquiry in order to meet improvement goals. Sue has served in a role of a critical friend, as just mentioned, to Canadian International School in Vietnam, and has shared her work in regard to creating international instructional leaders and improving students' achievement by changing teacher practice. As you have just heard, Sue is a skilled and inspiring educator and uses an inquiry model and looks forward to sharing her experience with us and in supporting schools and leaders in the school system in order to change the professional development and have meaningful and purposeful work. Her CV is quite long, and I would only advise you to contact her on Sue, which is sue.greer.consulting.ca. So we cannot have a better person talking about school leadership, effective school leadership through peer-to-peer learning, which in Canada is called learning networks. Sue, I'm sure with that understatement, you're welcome to take your seat. Thank you.
I really want to start by saying thank you for the invitation to come here to Rwanda. I have to tell you, when I go back to Canada, I'm going to be pleased to say to my colleagues in Canada that I've learned far more from being here than I ever thought possible. Sorry, thanks. I am in absolute awe of you folks here in Rwanda and the job that you are doing. I think the one thing that I am most envious about is that your children see education as a privilege. In Canada, and specifically Ontario, I think our children see education as a right. And they don't appreciate it as they should. So be very proud of the steps that you're taking, both in peer learning, but also in creating the standards for leadership. Because for those of you that are in the role of head of school, you know very well it's not an easy job. Some days you may be serving meals to kids. Some days you may be coaching kids. Some days you may be putting a Band-Aid on a child's knee. You're jack of all trades, as we say in Ontario. Anyway, you have lots to be proud of, and so with that, I'm just going to get started, because we're running a little bit behind time this morning. I just want to start. Unfortunately, I can't see what's behind me, so I'm going to use my notes in front of me, if that's okay. there are some significant commonalities between education in Ontario and education in Rwanda. And for me, that's very exciting, because when I think of your journey, I know that you're on the right journey. So that gives me confidence in what we're doing in Ontario, thinking that we're on the right journey as well. A little bit about Canada. Canada has 10 provinces and 3 northern territories. And each province and each territory has their own educational system. So when I come from Canada, but when I speak about the education, it's from the province of Ontario. In the province of Ontario, we have 12.8 million people. That's one-third of the total population in Canada. We have 152 languages and dialects. We have 72 boards and or districts. We have 1.3 million elementary students, and those students are between the ages of 4 and 12, and they're housed in approximately 4,004 elementary schools across the province. And we have 0.7 million secondary school students. And our secondary school students are the ages of 13 through 17. And they're in 909 schools across the province. We too have a Ministry of Education. And for the lack, I think I'll start by saying that terminology could get a little bit mixed up here. I may refer to something as a principal or an administrator. What I'm really speaking about is the head of school role. So we do call them school leaders, we call them instructional leaders, we call them principals, administrators, but it means the same thing. So our Ministry of Education has a goal for every student in Ontario. And that's that at least 75% of our students in grades 3 and 6 will achieve 75% or better on the standardized tests in reading, writing, and mathematics. Regardless of their social or economic backgrounds, and regardless of their educational level of functioning, which means that includes our special education children, that includes our English language learners, where English, the language that they're taught in, is not their first language. Again, at least 75% of students must pass and achieve 75% or better. You know as well as we know that the success, or the key to success in making that happen, is through strong instructional leaders. Because it's the strong instructional leaders that guide the teaching in the classroom. So, your heads of schools, you folks are doing the heavy lifting, because you're charged with achieving those kinds of standards in your schools as well. We too have an Ontario leadership framework. The research is very clear that school leaders are pivotal to the development of excellent teaching, ensuring excellent and safe schools, and ensuring that we have enhanced or improved student achievement. In fact, in Ontario, strong instructional leadership is such a significant part of our roadmap for improvement in student achievement that they've taken all the research and they too have come up with the Ontario Leadership Framework. And you were talking about standards for administrators or heads of schools yesterday. The province of Ontario has done that too. In fact, and I've copied the actual middle page for you, it should be on your tables, and they've given you the definition, or at least our Ontario definition of leadership. Leadership is the exercise of influence on organizational members and diverse stakeholders to the organization's vision and goals. Yesterday, Wellspring shared with us that a good leader is the main influencer for improvement in quality education. So you see, we're exactly the same. So what does that look like in a school? Well, our principals, your heads of schools, use their circle of influence with teachers to encourage them and help them find ways, not tell them, not demand of them, but help them find ways to change their teaching practice to meet the diverse learning needs of our students. And the reason it's so important that we don't demand or tell them, because if they don't create the desire to change their practice to improve student achievement, then it's not here in their heart. And they're doing it because someone else told them to do. So as soon as you shut the classroom door, they'll revert back to what they've always done. You don't achieve student improvement that way, for sure. So, professional standards for school leaders is essential. Just yesterday, Hans told us the purpose of the standards was for professional development, for recruitment, for reflection and self-evaluation, and for monitoring and evaluation. Well, guess what? That's the same for us. Only we take that and we created a vision for our administrators, if you will. And it's the underpinnings of the framework for all administrators for us. It's a shared vision. And a shared vision is absolutely essential if we're trying to build capacities in schools. It's not good enough to have one school over here that's achieving high levels and three neighboring schools over here performing below average. That's not acceptable. That's not equitable for all of our students. So we need a shared vision of what good, solid instructional leadership looks like. We need a common language, and that serves as a starting point for everyone. It's a clear understanding of what we know leaders must be. We need consistent practices that leaders must participate in. And in order to do those, you'll see at the bottom, actually, that there are specific characteristics that leaders must have. The framework outlines in each of the categories that collaboration and encouraging staff is essential if we're to move instructional practice forward. And that gets back to that influence that you have. Overall, the framework identifies the characteristics of highly performing schools and the role of the leader in making that happen, particularly in our context, through professional learning communities, or as you call it, peer-to-peer learning. So, that's the brief introduction of Ontario and the context that we come from, or that I come from, and already I'm sure you can see lots of similarities. So, today's task. The focus of the presentation really is to review what the research says about learning networks and network learning communities, or peer-to-peer teaching and learning, as you call it. And it's the route to changing practice. Ultimately, we want to achieve the vision and goal of improving student achievement in all schools. So the first one, the power or strengths, as well as the perils of learning communities. when they're not implemented with fidelity to the process. The second is to introduce you to the structure or model that enables professional learning within your context. The third is to talk a great deal about the learning focus and the importance of it. And the fourth is, of course, the collaborative inquiry. An inquiry is the engine of the learning community. And that, so getting to the new learning wasn't really happening. There was a significant amount of sharing, swapping stories, but it, essentially what they saw was people were sticking with the status quo. It wasn't reaching out to that new learning that we need to count on in order to change student achievement. So, the perils of learning communities. Learning communities can be good and they can be bad. So, what we are finding in the research that we've done is that there are four specific things that cause us to run into problems in working in peer-to-peer learning. The first one is quality control. Learning communities will spread whatever message is synthesized at that table. So we must pay attention to the research or the information coming back to the table and take it seriously. Because sometimes it's almost better to do nothing. I think in Canada we have a phrase, you put rubbish in, you get rubbish out. That's what they mean by quality control. The second issue for learning communities is groupthink. Quite often when we sit at the table and we're left to our own devices, everyone quickly settles on what we think we already know. But all that does is protect the status quo. What we really need to do is have that diversity of opinion. So the environment needs to be safe for everyone to contribute. And the third is diffusion of responsibility. Usually when you're a group of 5 or 10 people, there are a couple of people that are really the hard workers, the people that do it all. So the thing you have to guard against is what we call social loafing. There might be 4 or 5 people that sit in the background and say, well, I don't have to do the work because I know somebody else will. Everyone must participate equally in that. And the fourth one is de-individualization. Sometimes group identity can trump individual identity. And you never want to go there because it is the diverse opinion of every single person that helps us create the new knowledge. So the power of learning communities. The research is clear that the one-size-fits-all professional development doesn't have the impact that we need it to. It can be great for sharing system messages, but it's not great when it comes to new learning. So, if we start from the assumption that job-embedded professional learning really makes a difference, and that the contextual reality of your school, your system, matters, and we talked about that yesterday, then we realize that we can't rely on the vertical capacity building, which is somebody standing up here and talking to 500 people. It doesn't work. Not for what we need it to do anyway. So, in Canada, we don't have the kind of resources to create that just-in-time learning, to do it in that vertical way. And so, we've moved to the notion of lateral capacity building. And that's peer-to-peer learning. I come to the table with my problem of practice, given my school, the kids in my school, and the teachers in my school. And together, working with my colleagues, I can figure out an answer to go away and try something new. So, when we're sitting at the table, it gives us the opportunity to learn from one another. When there's an expert at the table that already has an answer that I've not tried. So I'm learning from them. With one another, none of us have the answer. We all go away. We seek out the research. we let it percolate through our heads in our example, bring it back, and give our opinions as to how we might go ahead and do that. Or we learn on behalf of one another. I, as head of school in this school, have a problem with having, for an example, a courageous conversation with a staff member. And it might be the one yesterday that was having a beer at lunchtime in the pub. I might have to have a courageous conversation with that staff member, but I'm not sure how to do that. So my learning is how to do that. My colleague, another head of school, doesn't need that right now. They're in a school where the staff members are all cooperative, working with them, and so on. However, 3 months down the way, I might have another